never know if it could change your life. Take a chance, you're neither wrong or right. You never know if you don't roll them dice. You better roll them dice. You never know if
hello, and welcome to Dungeon Master of None. I'm Dungeon Master Matt. I'm here with a special bonus episode reviewing MCDM Productions' new D&D 5th edition magazine, Arcadia. Now, I've been excited for this project for a long time, and I was just absolutely thrilled when the editor-in-chief of this new magazine, James Intricasso, sent us over a copy to review at Dungeon Master of None. Why am I excited to tell you about this project and why I wanted to take a bonus episode to share it with you? It's because, oh man, if you're like me, Dungeon and Dragon magazines, the old school TSR and then WotC and then Paizo magazines were one of the things that like really got me excited and thrilled about getting into Dungeons & Dragons and becoming a Dungeon Master. And they've been around for a long time. Dragon since the 1970s, and then Dungeon, a magazine just for Dungeon Masters, since before I was born. And it was really, really sad when those sort of licenses went away. Wizards of the Coast in 2007 or so basically canceled the licenses for these magazines, which they had given to this new company, Paizo, for basically the idea that we're going to move to fourth edition, have tighter control over all of our properties. Well, I mean, there were some really great side effects in that Paizo went out and did its own thing, created Pathfinder. But since then, while Paizo has published basically ever since then, monthly adventures and kind of continuing their adventure path, the idea of just kind of a magazine of random goodies of Dungeons and Dragons that you know has been, that you know is going to be somewhat high quality, has been really missing. And I think that is exactly what Arcadia sets out to do and what I think it does. Here's the deets. You can buy this magazine. It's digital only in PDF form online, link in the show notes at MCDM Productions, and it's very reasonably priced at $7. Kind of like a old school Dungeon or Dragon, what's in the magazine is a hodgepodge of Dungeons and Dragons goodies, a adventure ready for you to throw into whatever campaign you're running, some player options, in this case, a sorcerer subclass, an expansion on the rules for mounted combat and some new mounts, and some great NPCs at the very end. Now, the magazine opens with a message from James and the goals of this magazine. And based on MCDM's Patreon account numbers, which are going through the roof, I'm thinking this magazine will be a success. And after this quick review episode, I think you'll understand why. There's a quote from Matt Colville that says, "Arcadia, the magazine, should be full of stuff that is super actionable and really freaking dope." And I think that's Matt Colville speak for, you know, this magazine should be full of stuff that's useful at your table, for your characters, for your players, right now. Now, personally, I hate the word actionable. It makes me think I'm at work as opposed to playing a game, but it conveys the sort of vision of this magazine in that if you're used to, you know, maybe picking up at a half price bookstore or online old copies of Dungeon and Dragon, and you should if you're, you know, looking for a random adventure NPC or two to plop down, is that in addition to ads that are a window into years of gaming past, those magazines are full of, you know, Q&A, kind of letters to the editor, advice columns, columns on the ecology of a certain type of monster or an organization, stuff that is really fun to read and think about, but maybe isn't immediately relevant to your game. Now, personally, looking at a magazine from Matt Colville, a guy who is, well, he's made his bones in the Dungeons & Dragons community in many ways, but especially as someone giving advice to new Dungeon Masters, I was a little shocked that there wouldn't be a Matt Colville advice column, But as I look through this stuff, I sort of see where the vision is for this magazine, and that everything in this magazine is going to just be stuff immediately for your table. We're cutting out the bullshit and getting straight to the meaningful stuff. Now, in Dragon and in Dungeon's defense, that kind of those articles that are like, oh, How to Dungeon Master by Monty Cook, or letters about your campaign to the thing, are some of the stuff that is just kind of fun to read. But in this day and age, you know, we have people's Facebook posts and Twitter, I suppose, have replaced it. So I'll just have to let that go. Well, what's my overall review of Arcadia Issue 1? Well, I think it's really good. This is like what you're getting here for $7 is four entries that on their own could probably be worth that much on the Dungeon Masters Guild, all packaged together in some excellent layout and with some just amazing and beautiful art from cover to the final NPC. If that's not enough to convince you to give Arcadia a try, and if this sounds appealing, I really hope you do, because we have been missing a Dungeons & Dragons magazine for, gosh, I guess it's been over a decade now. There's been some online Dungeon & Dragon versions, but they were just never the same, and I really hope this takes off and continues to grow. Oh, gosh. For this review, and please don't do this unless you want to feel pain, I opened up Dungeons & Dragons Dragon Plus, which is their replacement for Dragon Magazine. And the most recent issue, it was just sort of ads for what you can buy from the Dungeons & Dragons line. And I felt deep sadness and hurting. Okay, let's dive in to the four entries in Arcadia Issue 1. The first thing you're going to get in Arcadia magazine is The Workshop Watches by Leon Baliaro. Now, this is a short, basically five-room dungeon, but it's one of the better or best ones that I've seen in a long time. I've said before when reviewing other published one-shot kind of modules that a really good published adventure has a great and clear concept and also sort of interesting execution in the details. And on both of those counts, The Workshop Watches fulfills. Basic idea of this adventure is that players are sent to a magical sentient wizard's laboratory, which has gone a little Red Queen glass DOS on its inhabitants, incinerating or murdering them, and players have to discover what's going on and either reach a diplomatic agreement with this arcane sentience named the Structure for Assistive Magic, or SAM, or destroy this mad mage robot before it can create a body and escape to the world. This concept, I bet if you heard this, you're like, oh gosh, if I've never done this, I've personally run a sentient spaceship for my player characters that they absolutely love. If you've never done sort of you're in a dungeon that's alive before, your players will absolutely love this type of adventure and honestly never forget it. Not only do we get this great concept, there's a ton of excellent execution actions that the arcane laboratory that's alive can take, some really interesting investigation as players try and uncover what's going on. The clues to maybe what has happened are plentiful and easy to find, always great in a published module. And at the very end, the players can have a dramatic showdown with this mad robot or try and turn it into a friendly intelligence. In addition, and this is just great, in the era of lockdowns and COVID, where we're mostly, if not exclusively, playing RPGs online, this adventure comes with not only a excellent map of the dungeon, but a gridless version and a link to the full-size JPEG in the PDF. So if you're playing on a virtual tabletop of any kind, All you have to do is open the link and copy that file in it, and it doesn't have the grid. And if you've run other publish modules and you're like, ah, my virtual tabletop comes with its own grid that like links to all my characters' abilities, but then if I have to match that grid up with the grid that's printed on the dungeon map, I'm just in a world of pain. And the fact that they included this shows that these authors have really thought about what will be most useful, or dare I say actionable, for players. If I have any critiques of this adventure, it's just at the very end, the final boss of the sentient magical laboratory is basically a shield guardian with an extra set of powers. It would have been nice to get a sort of a different monster of a workshop assembling itself. However, I think that's easy enough to reskin or re-describe. And, of course, the players have the option of taking this magical sentient robot with them. Great concept and excellent execution. The workshop watches. Next, we're given something for the players, and that's the Titan Heart subclass for the Sorcerer by Gabe Hicks. Now, Rob and I have talked a lot on the show about how we love more player options, but that the Sorcerer, because of the way its features are arranged in the main class and the subclass, is one of the hardest to design for. Sorcerers get very few features in their subclass, and so it can be really hard to make it interesting. However, I was super impressed with this subclass. The theme is your character has had an interaction or the blood of the ancient titans, colossi like the Kraken, or ancient pre-deity gods, and they can get really big. Mechanically, the Titan subclass kind of fulfills the same role that the Blade Singer School of Blade Singing Wizard does. Gives you a little bit of edge in melee combat, in addition to being able to grow large or huge in size. Overall, I think the subclass really works. One unusual feature that may give you pause before using it is the subclass relies and is built upon the mechanic of you can grow big and develop some unusual features that show off your Titan heart or your Titan heritage. And this lets you make melee attacks with your charisma modifier, grow large, deal extra damage to objects. But it also gives you access to 5 new first level spells, which are all kind of oriented around a sort of battle mage type play style of disabling opponents and creating difficult terrain area effects. It is unusual in that I don't think we've seen so far in 5th edition a subclass that gives you new spells when you have a feature active, and then you can't cast those spells when that feature is not active. To me, it feels a little bit like playing the subclass is like having one of those MOBA or like League of Legends characters that goes through a transformation and then their character operates differently for a period of time. To me, that's maybe less appealing, especially because these first level spells, sometimes they kind of overlap each other. There's a lot of them that are concentration. There's only one that's a bonus action. So, you know, that's the one you probably want to use most if you wanted to actually sink your teeth into the battle mage idea behind this subclass. But if you have players who really love that kind of MOBA-esque ideas behind a character, like, I grow big and I do different things now, this can be a lot of fun. Not only this, but and this is like the difference between something in this magazine and something you might find on the DMG. Not only do you have a fully fleshed out and well-written subclass that has great flavor and some really interesting mechanics, you also get an example NPC and an example retainer for this subclass. Both of these are great and come with great art. only criticism here is that unless you have Strongholds and Followers, also by MCDM Productions, the retainer rules are a little less useful to you because they rely on the specific rule set in that book. I think this magazine, in this case, suffers just a little bit of unforeseen consequences of Tasha's Cauldron of Everything coming out probably while this was wrapping up production and having its own rules for sidekicks or retainers that are significantly different than the retainer rules. However, it shouldn't be too difficult to convert this retainer to the published 5th edition sidekick rules. But otherwise, it's useful if you're willing to get Strongholds and Followers or already using those rules. That's The Titan Heart by Gabe Hicks. It's hard for me to choose a favorite in this magazine because, man, that adventure was really great. And the subclass kicked ass, but this might be my favorite section, and it's Jumping on Mounted Combat by Willie A. Beale. This section has a review of the already given 5th edition mounted combat rules, and then it provides some additional easy yet flexible rules for working kind of permanently with a mount for one of your player characters, and includes six sample mounts. Mounted combat is one of Rob and I's favorite things of the game that often gets left behind, and I think these rules, which gives you some kind of basic ideas of how a mount can evolve and grow with your player character, basically adding a character's proficiency bonuses or proficiency bonus to a lot of the amounts, attacks, defense, and stuff, is absolutely perfect and fits nicely alongside 5th edition's other design for pets and things like that. Each mount is based on an existing monster in the Monster Manual, the Warhorse, Owlbear, Nightmare, Hippogriff, Giant Toad, or Basilisk, and then you're given a couple special abilities for the mount and actions for the mount that are a little more appropriate for player characters to have, especially in the case of things like the Nightmare or the Basilisk that aren't going to overbalance or overpower other parts of your game. And the rules are simple enough that, you know, it makes a ton of sense for player characters using them, right? Oh, mounts, they usually dodge or dash, and that doesn't require an action. Do I want them to use a attack or a special attack? Well, I use my bonus action for that. Kind of the same as the universal pet rules that we saw in a lot of these subclasses or new class options in Tasha's Cauldron of Everything. And that's, again, where I think Arcadia suffered a little bit of unforeseen consequences, because I would have loved to see, with these mounts, a little bit of advice on, how do you incorporate subclasses that already have pets and kind of make them mounts. This section also had one bit of confusing rules. I wasn't quite sure. I tried to backwards design how they came up with the stats for the mounts from the Monster Manual entries. And I couldn't quite figure out how they changed the speeds and stuff. And it sort of brought me to, I guess, my only criticism, or one of two criticisms of this section, is, since this is a PDF, and obviously there is some formulae process that the authors and editors went through in order to convert entries in the Monster Manual into mounts for players. And I would have loved a paragraph, a half a page, two pages of rules on how to do that for basically most monsters in the Monster Manual, because if your player characters are anything like mine, they're going to want to turn basically any monster that they get an attachment with into one of their mounts, not just the five listed here. So a little bit of guidelines on how to do this for yourself would have made this, I think, like the perfect supplementary article, or the best one that I have ever read. The only other criticism I have is that under these rules, the mounts get temporary hit points at the beginning of every day or at the end of every long rest. There's a little bit of inconsistency in the rules here. Some say they get three times the character's level or challenge rating if it's an NPC. Some say they get four. Is that a typo, or are some more powerful? It was very unclear to me, especially because some say in the rule summary three, and then in the actual text four. I was also very confused by the choice of temporary hit points, which are kind of a funky rules case that don't always come up very often, and actually, you know, in this case seem less powerful than regular hit points, because you won't be able to heal them back up. And, you know, if you're asking players to keep a separate character sheet or place to track their mount's stuff, making them track two pools seems more complicated than just giving them a straight amount of hit points plus their hit points grow as your character levels up, which is basically how the pets in the new Tasha's Guide to Everything work. So if those changes came out, if we got some rules for building your own mounts, maybe a short half page character sheet for the mounts, this would be perfect. But there was something here that I didn't even ask for, which is basically a very short, not exactly adventure, but encounter that focuses on mounts, that your players who want to try out these rules, if you want to experiment with these rules without sort of breaking out of your regular game, will work really nicely. So that was Jumping into Mounted Combat by Willie A. Buell. Last but not least, we're given a section on some high-level NPCs, Ukwaville, the Recreant by Sadie Laurie. Now, listeners to our episode on Eyes Unclouded, an anthology of Dungeons & Dragons adventures inspired by Japanese animation, will be familiar with Sadie Laurie. As a designer, she gave us a great adventure in that collection about wizards in a floating wizard school negotiating with other planar entities and stealing their hearts and throwing the planes out of balance. And here she has given us two great NPCs that would be perfect for a, you know, Fate of the Multiverse campaign ending arc, Ukwaville and Anihita. And we also get stats for these super 20 CR creatures. Now, without getting into too much spoiler territory, the hooks for these creatures are definitely, you know, a cosmic soap opera of betrayal and a moral outlook on the multiverse. So if you're looking for some really cool high-level NPCs for just a regular campaign, for a Planescape campaign, there's a lot of mystery here, and I love how they're presented, with the author giving us about three different ways to introduce these NPCs, and then like four different ways to move the plot forward from there. So it's definitely like a guideline for a huge arc of your game that can absolutely roll with the punches and in what your players are interested in that final spot. And of course, I should be mentioning this for the entire thing, but the art of these celestial planar NPCs is absolutely brilliant, as is the art in the rest of this book. That's Ukwaville, the Recreant by Sadie Laurie. Final thoughts on Arcadia the magazine. I couldn't think of a better way to spend $7 on Dungeons & Dragons supplements. One of the lovely things about the old school, I guess, magazines like Dragon is they often gave you things you didn't know you were looking for, right? And today with people publishing supplements or things on the DMs Guild, right, you're probably only going to buy things that you were already interested in. And since Arcadia gives us a whole bunch of things, right, I wasn't thinking of, you know, doing an extra dungeon, but, you know, this one's going to be perfect. I wasn't thinking of having an angel in one of my campaigns, but the sort of story hooks given in the final section are going to fit super well for one of my lunchtime D&D games. That's what I love about it. Things that might give you pause. I think this is available if you're an MCDM Patreon, but you can also just buy it piecemeal. One thing is that if you're just a player, there's really only a subclass for you, and I suppose the mounted combat rules if your dungeon master is willing to play along. One of the, I think, things that made Dungeon Dragon work is that one was for players and one was for dungeon masters. This is something for everyone. I suppose if there was future issues, you know, and this continues to grow, that's possibly in the cards. If I had any other criticisms besides the ones I've already voiced, it's that the name was a little confusing to me, and I wasn't sure. I knew that MCDM was working on a magazine and that I was super excited to get it when it came out. I didn't know it was called Arcadia. And I guess to me, Arcadia has a bunch of connotations and associations, none of them particularly with Dungeons and Dragons. I had to look up where this name came from, and apparently it's a reference to a demiplane, plane of existence in Matt Colville's homebrew game. And so I'm guessing it has a bunch of significance for him and people who follow his game. But if you're outside of that, you might be like, oh, have you seen Arcadia? I'm like, what is that in? Is that in Louisiana? Is that in Canada? No. We're talking Dungeons and Dragons here. So the one thing that my only final critique is that the name is just a little bit confusing, but the great thing about that critique is it doesn't matter. Anyway, that's all for this short bonus episode of Dungeon Master of None. If this looks at all interesting, and I guess I highly recommend it, I would say check out issue number one of Arcadia, and if this is successful, maybe we're back in business. We've got our monthly Dungeons & Dragons magazine back, and no one will be happier about that than me. All right, thanks for listening. If you enjoyed the show, leave us a quick rating or review, and as always, keep rolling them dice.
Yippee-yi-yo, yippee-yi-yi, Zydeco to night, Zydeco pasale. Yippee-yi-yo, yippee-yi-yi, Zydeco to night, Zydeco pasale. Yeah. Yippee-yi-yo, yippee-yi-yay, Zydeco to night, Zydeco pasale. When I say the yippee.